In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. So, in this talk, I would like to cover the works of John the Cross in general, particularly on the Ascent in Dark Night, since that's what I wish to start with. So, John the Cross wrote four major works, the Ascent of Mount Carmel and Dark Night, which actually go together because he finished the Ascent of Mount Carmel abruptly and actually didn't finish it. And so what was going to be the fourth book, there were three books, the fourth book he ended up not covering, and so he covered that in his book, Dark Night. Now, both of these are based on his poem, The Dark Night. Then he wrote his Spiritual Canticle, which is based upon his poem, Spiritual Canticle. And finally, Living Flame of Love, which, as you can guess, is based on his poem, Living Flame of Love. What I also like to talk on are his precautions and his counsels for religious on how to reach perfection. And we have sayings of his, which he gave to his confers or what people got from his letters. And we have a few letters, unfortunately not too many. His poetry, which is actually first and foremost, in earlier works of John the Cross, they had the poems at the end. And then I noticed in more recent, well, now about 30 years old, but in more recent times, they put the poems at the very beginning of the book. And I think that's most appropriate. And then I'd also like to give a talk at some point on some drawings of his, which had a lot of meaning behind them, especially that of the Ascent of Mount Carmel. Now, again, this is just a very general run through of each book. What I plan to do is give talks on just particular points in the book, not to just go through the book giving a thorough class on them. That I would prefer to do, for like 50-minute talks in a classroom, and these talks are shorter, so I just like pick out some particular points, hopefully draw interest in John the Cross. So in his Ascent to Mount Carmel, as I said, which is based on the poem Dark Night, he starts out with the poem and he's following it, obviously. And then at some point, he puts it aside and he tries to bring it back, but it ends up getting put aside and not covered again. Then in Dark Night, he brings it in and covers the stanzas that he wishes to cover, and then he just simply ends the book. In the Spiritual Canticle on the Living Flame of Love, he goes through each poem entirely. So that's why the latter two are sort of a different format from the former two. But there's either way, you learn much from he wrote, and it's nice having different styles. So Ascent to Mount Carmel has three books. In the first book, he talks about active purification. He talks about the active night of the senses and the spirit and passive night of the senses and the spirit. It fits in also with the traditional way of the purgative, illuminative, and unitive way. He talks about the night as being what's in between each one of those stages. But basically, night means mortification or redirecting, for example, the senses and the spirit, so that God is first and foremost, so that we become saints. So in discussing the active night of the senses, which is general mortification of the senses, he doesn't go into detail saying you need to only eat three meals a week and it can only be bread and water and you can't sleep at night. And no, he is very good at leaving that open for each individual. Also at that time in religious life, the standards were pretty or the practices were pretty standard. So what he does is he shows about what the end is. that is seeking God and obtaining union with God. In fact, I want to give a talk on chapter 13, which is towards the end of that book. It's just wonderful. That's anyway, I'm looking forward to that. I suppose there's a good general summary of book one. In book two, he says he's talking about the active night of the spirit. So it's the same. It's a matter of mortifying yourself, but now in the aspect of the spirit, and he's talking about faith. That's an important point I should make here. The Ascent of Mount Carmel and Dark Night, those books are based on faith. Whereas Spiritual Canticle and Living Flame of Love is based on love, on charity. However, it's not just those points by themselves, those virtues by themselves, because in the Ascent of Mount Carmel, as I hope to show, he covers faith, hope, and charity, all three of them, and obviously mentions all three in the latter two books as well. However, that's what his main point of concentration is on, though. Spiritual Canticle and Living Flame of Love, it's about a soul in love. Whereas Ascent of Mount Carmel and Dark Night is more sort of like a map. This is how you get there. He shows the importance of faith, and that'll be fun to talk on. And here in book two, is basically the point that he makes is the faith and the relation it has with our intellect. Makes various divisions, but anyway, I guess that's a good overview on that one. Going on to book three, I try to keep these things very general. It's hard to do. I want to go into more detail. In book three, he talks about the purification of the memory with the virtue of hope. And then in the latter part of that, he speaks about charity and purifying the will. Maybe what's good to understand is he uses that threefold division of the intellect, memory, and will. But of course, he refers to the rest of how our human nature. For example, we have our feelings, our emotions, we have our senses, we have an imagination. So I think these are very, especially the primary factors of the soul, the intellect and the will, makes sense to have it based on that. So it's all put together very well. It's not just an awkward format that he puts there. You will see from his writings, he uses each one of these to express the spiritual life, advice for spiritual life very well. Also, I think a good point to make here when it comes to the Ascent of Mount Carmel, which I learned the hard way when I first read it. I got a modern way of thinking. I'm used to chronological order. So I read book one. I thought, okay, that's the first stage. Book two is the second stage. Book three is the third stage. No, what he does is in book one, well, it's like an earlier stage, but let's say particularly book two and book three, when he's talking about the intellect and purification, what the soul undergoes, he's basically talking about all the way through the spiritual life. Then he talks about the memory and the will. He's going through the whole spiritual life, so it's not one before the other. That's why when speaking of the intellect, he gives the three signs for contemplation, and those, which I will also cover in a talk, those three signs he also gives in his book Dark Night. So it shows these are things that are going on at the same time. That's why active and passive is a good division, I think, to make. So in Ascent of Mount Carmel, he's talking about what we do on our part. Obviously, God is involved. He always is. But still, these are things that we need to do on our part. When he talks about Dark Night, it's more a matter of embracing what God is doing on his part. So that active and passive. So then he, in speaking of the will, he started making divisions, like the four primary emotions, joy, hope, sorrow, fear. And he starts talking about how he planned to divide each one of those. And he goes into joy, makes a division, another division, another division. And at a certain point, I mean, it's wonderful to read, but at a certain point, he realized that he had strayed from the poem and he wasn't getting near to the Dark Night. And that's another good point to make about his ascent to Mount Carmel. He makes it very clear that he is covering those purifications and what we do on our part just as a prerequisite for talking about passive purification. The main reason John of the Cross was writing was to talk about passive purification. That is the aspect of the spiritual life which was so neglected, being covered and teaching others about. And he makes it very clear, I need to get on. I want to talk about passive purification and the dark night, need to get on. And in the meantime, he was making all these divisions. So at a certain point he said, you know what? I've covered enough, and that's it. He just stopped writing the book and gave out to people, and copies were made. That's why we know that's where it ended, and it's not that pages were lost or things like that, because that's all the copies end at the same point. And then he himself wrote Dark Night as a separate book, which he said in the Ascent to Mount Carmel was supposed to be the fourth part of that book. So in the book Dark Night, he picks up then talking about passive purification. So the passive night, senses and spirits. And again, I found it very inspiring, and which I say again because I mentioned my last talk, but it's just wonderful. So he talks about he goes through the seven capital vices, and he had such a great mind. So to instruct in the spiritual life, he goes through these capital vices, but not in the way that we usually think of them. He applies them all to the spiritual life. For example, gluttony. We just think, well, gluttony is when you don't mortify your senses. And obviously, it's just overeating, whatever. But here, when he talks about gluttony, he's talking about spiritual gluttony. So say a person is always seeking consolation in prayer, and they're always seeking to have more. And if they're consoled in a certain way, after a while, they want more and more and more. And it's a really good analogy to a person who's addicted to eating. And so, and it goes through all of them because of anger and sloth and like spiritual sloth, not persevering when there are times of darkness and dryness in prayer. It's wonderful. So he goes through all of that, and he makes reference to that. The way I like to look at it is like a lawn. Let's say not a lawn, but weeds. You have a field of weeds, and you go out there with a mower, and you cut all the weeds flat, and everything looks great. Hey, they're still green, but they're short. Everything looks good. That's basically when you go through the passive night of the senses. But he says the roots are still there. The weeds are still there, and they're going to grow. They're going to come back. And so he talks about the night of the spirit, and this particular where God is primarily involved, like St. Teresa is talking about in her six mansions of her interior castle. And so that is what book two is on. It's a matter of uprooting each one of these vices, these bad habits. Just not doing something for God alone. And it says, as he goes through that, it's true, it could seem, maybe the first time I read it, I wasn't looking at the words close enough. But I mean, there are some things he said that could seem like rather, whoa, okay, this is really serious what we're talking about here. This is really intense. But then he goes on and talks about God's love. It's just wonderful how he goes on speaking God's love. And that's why, I mean, I think sometimes people say, well, when you give someone to read John the Cross's works, they should read, Living Flame of Love first. But sometimes I think maybe even just pick the second half of book two in Dark Night when he's talking about what it means for a soul to be united with God. It's just very inspiring. So I look forward to covering some of those aspects. As for the spiritual canticle, Living Flame of Love, it's easy to give a summary because basically he goes through his poems and explains them stanza by stanza, line by line. Just very wonderful. It's just great specific teachings that are there. It'd be fun to bring them out. And Living Flame of Love, he does the same. It's a much shorter poem. But in 3 points, you could say he was sidetracked, so to say. It was, and he talks about the dark night and practical aspects as well. So it's not just something that's, way out there. Very practical. So I will just include a couple other things. He has his precautions and his counsels for religious to reach perfection. So it's both very short writings, but had a significant part in my life. I was very impressed when I read those, and I've been keeping them in my pocket for many years. Always something nice to pull out and read. We have sayings of light and love, as is often presented. We have a couple of drawings of his. I look forward to going over his letters and his poetry, which is first and foremost. Pardon me if I might have made that point before going to the other works. I've been trying to make different presentations, and I forget what I said in the earlier ones. So, what I would like to do now is to start on in my next talk, pick out some points. I'd like to go in chronological order, so to say, so beginning with the ascent and then going through the other works accordingly. However, what I would like to do is first just to present some direct quotations of John of the Cross. I think they really properly present his love. So I will end here with a prayer and then go on with that. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. In the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.